Welcome everybody to the Keats-Shelley House, and a special welcome to our guest this afternoon, who joins us all the way from Athens, where she is the Literary and Arts Chair in Greece for the International Friends of the Bibliotheca Alexandrina, the Library of Alexandria.
It's like the newest, oldest library of the world.
The newest, oldest library of the ancient world. Ginger Zaimis is also the author of three collections of poetry, which she has brought along today, and which she's going to show us. The most recent collection is just about to be published in the next couple of months.
The forthcoming is Therapy with Antigone, and the trilogy verses.
Yes, so that will be coming in the next couple of months.
That's right.
Yeah. And Ginger is also the author of two new poetic forms inspired by classical architecture, the Triptych and the Portico. I'm sure she'll tell us about that in a moment. And she is a polymath, a poet, and a polyglot, it would seem, as well as a translator from ancient and modern Greek into English, which is really quite astounding. And she is going to talk today about certain connecting themes which I think are close to all of our hearts. The Romantics and Greece, myth, transcendence, love, and beauty. Ginger Zaimis.
Thank you. Thank you, Giuseppe. Thank you for the very erudite, elegant introduction. It's an honor to be here, and thank you all for coming out. And a special shout out to Sophie Downs. Thank you very much. So I would like to talk to you about various themes and textiles and layers. My world, in essence, I see through architectural lenses, and not only architecture, but very much mythology and philosophy. In fact, one could even say that really I embrace Heraclitan themes within this synergy of perspective, and so I navigate literature or poetry through these lenses, if you will. But getting back to the Romantics and Greece, synchronistically or not, in 1821, John Keats died in this very house, and it was the same year that Greece embarked upon revolution, a civil war, actually. And it would be a few years later that Byron would so ardently embrace Greece after his first trip to his pilgrimage, if you will, to Greece, and would come back a bit after 1821 as a newfound Greek statesman, or newfounded statesman of Greece, if you will, and advocate that revolution. I feel that Byron, in his perspective of Greece, the beauty he found in Greece was simply Byron falling in love with himself through the eyes of Greece. And, you know, many people agree or disagree, it's just a perspective. But knowing Greece as a philologue, as a writer, as an English-speaking native, and New Victorian, if you will, Southerner. I feel like I've touched upon many common themes that Byron, Shelley, and Keats also embraced in their work. And but before we talk about all of this, I'd like to take you back a few thousand years, and back to ancient Greece and Alexandria and the pre-Socratics. And let's look at what possible fragments that these romantic poets, these writers, these particular second generation romantics experienced, or perhaps perceived through different eyes, and how they basically stood in situ, kind of co-creating in the shadow of the divine. So Heraclitus talks about as above, so below. So this whole synergy of how we understand the physical and the non-physical world from the ancient or metaphysical perspective kind of comes into play here, but maybe not in the most obvious sense. here he implies there's unity in opposites. And I think Sophocles very much addresses this through his particular, his literary work. Simply because long before there was Plato's Timaeus, and long after Heraclitus's Cosmic Harmony, Greek literature expressed a ceaseless rhythm of music through lyrical and oral poetry. So the Orphic hymns, as we know, in the tradition of the Orphic hymns, was simply reminiscent of that music being orchestrated throughout nature. And I think we see that not only humanity, but also nature, very, very specifically, nature need not be musically, you know, these beings also being very, very much musically inspired. And I think what the pre-Socratics really kind of hit on, in my perspective, is really this universal resonant vibration or energy, which is in essence very much like music. It is frequency. So this poetic metrical rhythm of verse is very much what the Romantics and their formalism embraced. So according to Proclus in Plato's Cosmology, he compares the cosmic reality to certain conceptions of music and harmony of. And again, there is that comparison, that analogy to frequency or energy in space, in essence, in its most simplest form, that everything and nothing, that ebb and flow, that volume and void, actually. And Anaxagoras also talks about this, though he approaches the cosmology from a different perspective. And it was said that after philosophy and science, art was the last manifestation of human consciousness to have been liberated from magic and myth, now, in the mystical realm. In fact, the artistic process, or the creative process, is initiated in an external world, though it's expressed from an internal space, that inner space of consciousness, these formal integrities. So here again, there are these references to literally co-creating in the shadow of the divine. Now, we know from quantum physics that energy cannot be destroyed nor created, it can simply be reshaped. So these Romantic poets, using the textiles and inspiration and their perceptions of what they experienced, stepping out of their cultural consciousness, coming to Greece, certainly experienced fragments of all of this. And it was that kind of reshaping of impression through Romantic eyes, rose-colored glasses, that came forth, this lyrical rhythm of ode and sonnet and iambic pentameter, which is, you know, very indicative of the English language. In fact, I was having a conversation today with a scholar, and we were basically talking about how the brain is imprinted. And really, the brain is imprinted as any architectural space based on the language it first hears. And as a Southerner, as an English-speaking native and a Southerner, I came to realize later, after I came to bond with poetry and literature, that the natural discourse of the English language as I learned it actually rhythmically flows in iambic pentameter. So I feel very keen and very close with the sonnet form. And this is something I feel comes naturally from me, simply because I think it was the way my brain was conditioned, how it learned the English language. So, going back to the Romantics, this whole co-creating in the shadow of the divine is basically perhaps a metaphor to the Trinity, that 1 + 1, which is 3, which in essence one could see it perhaps as a derivative of the Pythagorean theorem. But nonetheless, there's that space, that energy, and that new creation, once that energy and space comes in to union, forming that new third. So I'm going to start off, and I'm going to read some excerpts of Childe, Harold Byron's baby, if you will, and really to kind of lay the foundation of how I believe Byron saw Greece, and then I'm going to pair it with some personal poetry, and we'll see what we get. So, and this whole ekphrastic theme, or ekphrasy, as we know in Greek, which is also a new word that's been appropriated into the English lexicon, very much comes into play with the poetry that we're going to talk about tonight. In fact, we see it with Byron, we see it with Keats particularly, and we see it with Shelley. So, Childe, Harold, Canto I, Stanza 1. O thou in Hellas deemed of heavenly birth, muse, formed or fabled at the minstrel's will, since shamed full oft by latter lyres on earth, mine dares not call thee from the sacred hill, yet there I've wandered by the vaunted rill, yes, sighed over Delphi's long deserted shrine, where have that feeble fountain, all is still, nor mote my shell awake the weary nine, to grace so plain a tale, this lowly lay of mine. So, in this first canto, I actually imagine Byron standing at the foot of the Acropolis at the Philippopal Hill, which is basically the sanctuary of the muses, and kind of like looking, and I don't know, and I could be wrong, in the sanctuary of the muses, as many may or may not know, is basically a plateau that overlooks the Acropolis, but it's actually right below where they imprisoned Socrates. So Socrates' prison. So I can kind of like see him like ruminating and kind of, you know, calling his muse, if you will, or muses. Canto 2, Stanza 1. Come, blue-eyed maid of heaven, but thou, alas, didst never yet one mortal song inspire. Goddess of wisdom, here thy temple was and is, despite of war and wasting fire and years that bade thy worship to expire. But worse than steel and flame and ages slow is the dread scepter and dominion dire of men who never felt the sacred glow that thoughts of thee and thine on polished breasts bestow. Canto 3, Stanza 2. Once more upon the waters, yet once more, and the waves bound beneath me as a steed, and the waves that knows his rider, welcome to their roar, swift be their guidance, whereas so it lead through the strained mast should quiver as a reed, and the rent canvas fluttering strew the gale, still must I on, for I am as a weed flung from the rock on ocean's foam to sail, wherever the surge may sweep, the tempest's breath prevail. So I feel that there's like these undertones of like Aphrodite in her like realm, kind of like, you know, emotively circling about in the foam here. Canto 4, Stanza 177. There is pleasure in the pathless woods. There is rapture on the lonely shore. There is society where none intrudes. By the deep sea and music in its roar, I love not man the less, but nature more. from these are interviews in which I steal from all I may be or have been before to mingle with the universe, to feel, and I can never express, yet cannot all conceal. So I feel that Byron's senses have kind of been awakened as he arrives in Greece, and he experienced this diverse like topography of like mountain and sea, of myth and man, and this convergence of history and culture. And I feel like, again, there's this inner shift, this kind of coming into alignment with who he is, and this reconnection and reinterpretation and reshaping of form and thought, which he pulls from his head, like thread, into Childe Harold. Byron would then later come back to Greece, I think it was about 1823-ish, and embrace the revolution in Missolonghi, and then he would meet his end, or his maker, if you will, ultimately in Greece. But the poem I'm going to read to you now is a poem that basically calls the muse. It's one of mine. It was very much inspired by a Spartan theme of in 2014, when Greece was ready to break or default from Europe. And literally Athens was burning and demonstrating and rioting, and I sat formally at the forefront of theater, or democracy's theater, Syndagma, Constitution Square, and watched this happen.
I'm sorry.
Of course.
I would like a gentle song.
And so I think a lot of people who were there at the time really felt this sense of despair and, what will happen to Greece? Will she break from Europe? And there was, emotions were heated and running wild, very much as I sense Byron may have felt during the revolution, the war, clearly in a different context, similar yet different. And so this poem came out. We were actually with some friends who were baptizing their child, and they were baptizing her Ourania, which is also the muse of the sky. Ourania. A sky without limit as light beacons ordains. Fair muse, sister of history, child tender sweet, today they blessed your soul in his holy name, while we waited with half breath for Greece to break, default from Europe, her birthplace. Some will remind when you are grown, ask about your name, celestial cloth of grace, and you'll say that joy usurped us from task, erasing the fear to reinvent our past with laughter. Love that heals all uncuts, or sound like water which ripples fast across land, valley, and sea as oil deruts, seeming differences with mutual interests, while scissors and fabric in hand recut. So, I'd like to now proceed on to Keats's Ode to a Grecian Urn. And again, very ekphrastically speaking, we see his words, his letters, his images quite vivid as a tapestry as he weaves, in and out. And I'm not going to read the whole ode, I'm going to read excerpts from the ode. The poem begins as the narrator silences the urn and or the bride, in essence, the bride of quietness, and he speaks on behalf of her. Ode to a Grecian Urn, lines 1-2. Thou still unravished bride of quietness, thou foster child of silence and slow time. And I think it's interesting that he uses these particular words, because really I think sometimes, and maybe writers do or do not, but I think we take for granted the power and the directives of the words that we wield. And here he chooses them very carefully, the urn being a foster child and silence, and slow time being perhaps stone crafted from without one who had words or letters to impart. Lines 3-10. Sylvan historian, who canst thus express a flowery tale more sweetly than our rhyme? What leaf-fringed legend haunts about thy shape of deities or mortals or of both? In Tempe or the dales of Arcady? What men or gods are these? What maidens loth? What mad pursuits? What struggle to escape? What pipes and timbrels, and what wild ecstasy? So there's like this eternal kind of brooding or scene that he's setting elaborately, and the urn is still quiet, though he speaks on her behalf. And what does the urn say? Lines 46-50. When old age shall this generation waste, thou shalt remain in midst of other woe, then ours a friend to man, to whom thou sayest, beauty is truth, truth is beauty, that is all. Ye know on earth, and all ye know need to know. So I think those are very, very much words to the wise. I too felt very inspired, ekphrastically speaking, some years ago. And when I was working on my first new poetic form, I was quite taken by the facade or the archetype of a classical temple, and very much involved with Vitruvian themes and the golden ratio, it occurred to me this repetitive ideology, this symmetry, this eurythmy, these six tenets of architecture were not only present in architecture in a formal context, they were actually present in a non-physical space, and also as well as physical space, and how actually these tenets kind of had spiritual undertones. So the idea was, being very fond of the sonnet and rhyme and meter, I wanted to emulate or experiment with sound, silent sound, or as the portico or porch of a classical temple, the columns would be. So, the first generation poem came forth. It's called the Karyatides. It is reminiscent of the Erechtheian temple, which stands adjacent to the Acropolis. It is a very curious temple. It is a temple shaped with symmetry and eurythmy. And I dedicated it to Edward Lear, who was a very, very much a fan of Greece and Philolene, and an avid painter and writer in his Limerick form. But really, it was more about his painting, that ekphrastic understanding of words and images. So the Karyatides. And I've sourced the provenance from the Caryatids, the mythology of where the Caryatids come from Vitruvius Pollio's D'Architectura for century AD. So, portico of six, Rom adjacent to, beauty a eurythmic, adjoined carefully to, maidens of the Caryae, all from Laconia, commitment lifetime, obligation diva, proconsuls to another, agora spread below, on head entablature, sculpted figures in tow, sisters of alas, less one via London, stolen like Helen, usurped from home, girls of the nut tree, devotes of Artemis, made for her temple, circled dance with reeds, enslaved for betrayal, Persia versus Athena, treacherous to stay, basket head coronas. Maybe the statues they will be too tired to hold, shall concur one day this crumbling world. Let's go, don't wait. Get up and leave, girls. Recreate our fate like Dharma and pearls. So if you recall the six Caryatids at the Erechtheion on the porch, there's four and then two in the back. And as the poem suggests, literally they were turned to stone for betraying Athena in the Persian War and doomed to hold the temple for life, according to Vitruvius. So, now let us proceed. Let us proceed along to Shelley and Aeschylus. As my bio suggests, yes, my poem, or my collection, my current collection, Prometheus Rebound, and other mythology, delves into the realm of myth and philosophy, appropriating Aeschylus's tale of Prometheus the Titan and Shelley's Unbound to my Rebound. And this whole play on words, basically a play written in sonnet cycles, is which imbues the title of the book, is it reshapes that word bound and how we perceive it. And so basically I progress the mythology from how Hesiod tells the tale of Prometheus through Aeschylus' version, and then how Shelley perceives Prometheus through mercy and clemency. So here, again, though Shelley was not entirely politically inclined, Byron was much more politically inclined. This particular sonnet cycle, this play, has political undertones and overtones of modern Greek politics. In fact, it is actually set in January 2015, when Athens was burning and rioting and burning. And there was this shift in of new administration, political paradigm shift, in essence. And basically what it does is it juxtaposes the metaphor of fire as vanity and deceit this time around, and Prometheus is caught red-handed, basically stealing these two energies from the gods, giving them to humanity without expanded consciousness. So, and basically we're dealing with universal law here, the whole cause, the law of cause and effect, and action reaction, and how this has precipitated this kind of like boiling pot of the Mediterranean, if you will, for Europe and the world. And so the play on the word bound progresses from bound to unbound to rebound. And then again, there's this kind of multiple layers of meaning of rebound. Is Greece rebound to Atlas-like debt this time around, or are they rebound for clemency from their European lenders? And how that all plays out. So, the cast, Zeus, Prometheus, Pantheon jury, the echoes and Mother Earth and the chorus. Post-Greek elections, January 2015, the Athenian capital. Act 1, enter Zeus, Prometheus, and the Pantheon jury. And I'd like to say here, just as a footnote, very similar to what Keats does with his Grecian urn, where he silences the heroine or the protagonist. Here also Prometheus is silenced. You believed your sight greater than thine, mine. Titan, whose plotting thought proved foolish. Spinning reason in circles like the dervish, while grains of my patience drop in time. What has your penance pain taught you? I sent heaven's winged hound, the hawk, to gnaw your liver when bound to a rock, though this treason seeks jury times two. You bequeathed vanity's mirror, more fair than my divine blood ensue, like Helen, as if her beauty differ from her father, monarch of all Zeus, or Venus, the rose light in the temperate sky. How you challenge your fate again, defy. Act 2, Prometheus and Zeus. With narcissism, is democracy rot? You fed the bald muggle the hubris seed, filling his head with noise, less coherent thought, ego which fueled vanity like feral deceit. True. I steered both the green-horned premier, who palmed the wheel that wielded power when cauldron burnt bridges with hot air, and mortal minutiae in the last giddy hour. Without consciousness, it's a blame game. Politics void of a plan to rebuild destiny's new suit, yet allowed a t-shirt to maim. Respect one for all, democracy's loot, blasphemy against the gods, while I pulled from my head ideas, child. Act 3, enter the echoes. Still the parliament parrots all the while, like echoes, the weight of the wind wills, as memorandum or laws that bill taxes or debt to deleverage denial. Enter Mother Earth. While man lords face stupidity high, still asking for mother's comfort and loan, oblivious to their action they moan. Yours, his, the final judgment is nigh. The echoes. She dare not speak more, lest the sky hear the curse once breathed on thee is twice near. Repent, Titan, give thanks and say a prayer. Forget your arrogance if you dare. Unveil the beast of delusion that hides. Use Athena's shield, conscious yet wise. Act 4. Zeus and Prometheus. Enter. You shall reap your sentence as accused. Prometheus, who gave man fire by theft, who left the ocean-eyed Asia bereft, child of Gaia, who challenged Zeus, while Aeschylus's words seemed to heal, prove my clemency of grace from Tartarus's groove. Your love for man is primitive, crude, but your betrayal twice is flat-out rude. Enter Pantheon jury. Ignorance. Indeed, a fool's folly, it is. What inexperience affords times to, and the pursuit of chaos from paradise. Enter chorus. Justice, per accusation, will never soothe, but rankle in history, undisguised, while Jove's ego prickles, still broods. Cause and effect, these are your dues. So, within that piece of work, there was various appropriations of Shelley's Unbound, which was then like rewoven and basically reprogressed or progressively rewritten mythology. And the whole idea that cause and effect really is this whole like energy that's given in exchange, and how it plays out on a geopolitical spectrum as well as even on a personal spectrum. So where are we? Am I talking too much? Should I shut up? Yes, okay. So, I think we're going to close on a theme which I find quite interesting. Plato talked about as well, too. Aristophanes wrote about it per Plato's request. And you know, basically, what would any romantic be less the love and partnership in a lifetime? So the topic brings us to sacred love, partnership, and union. And what immediately comes to mind when I think of this is the whole mythology of Osiris and Isis and even Odysseus and Penelope, as well as Eros and Psyche. And how, you know, the star-crossed lovers ebb and flow and, you know, similar yet different, and they're energetically drawn in and drawn out from each other and then drawn back in, only again to separate. And so, though Keats's ode to Psyche shifts a bit, the traditional myth of Eros and Psyche, I think, again, it puts a different perspective, yet incorporates the themes. So, and I like how he plays or progresses this mythology from a personal perspective, to a point where, in the beginning of the ode, we see Psyche as an ordinary, beautiful child who Aphrodite is like basically sicked her son on to, you know, deconstruct the well, beautiful and lovely maiden, but then falls hopelessly in love. And it was really through the light that Psyche's actually able to reveal his presence. And then I like also how he basically, you know, having to deal with like the mother-in-law to be, which is a very, very real theme on many regards, is unable to kind of sweet talk her into, like, you know, allowing Psyche into his realm. He solicits his grandfather, Zeus, and basically turns Psyche into a goddess. So there's this whole progression of human to goddess, and this metaphor that basically, when she was in mortal form, she was, you know, this beautiful yet feeble creature who almost dies in the end, but then is transformed into a goddess or a deity. And I think really, if you look at the mythology, possibly there is cause to believe that she was in essence out of alignment before that transformation and that coming into alignment with simply the progression of that transformation, if you will. But anyway, just a personal opinion. So, Ode to Psyche. I wandered in a forest thoughtlessly, and on the sudden, fainting with surprise, saw two fair creatures couched side by side. In deepest grass, beneath the whispering roof of leaves and trembled blossoms, where there ran a brooklet, scarce spied. The winged boy I knew. But who wast thou, O happy, happy dove, his Psyche true? So in lines 36 through 43, we see how, like, suddenly Keats is, like, kind of amassing this inspiration to almost kind of step into the advocate of Psyche, almost become, like, her priest, if you will, and, you know, praising her. O brightest thou too light for antique vows, too late for the fond believing lyre, when holy were the haunted forest boughs, holy the air, the water, and the fire. Yet even in these days so far retired from happy pieties, thy lucent fans fluttering among the faint Olympians, I see and sang my own eyes inspired. So now this transformation has happened, and Psyche's kind of come into her own. And through the imagination of Keats, he's like, he's totally her advocate. He's singing her praises. Yes, I will be thy priest and build a fane in some untrodden region of my mind, where branched thoughts, new gown with pleasant pain, instead of pines, shall murmur in the wind. So the ode concludes in this kind of awakening of consciousness and this allowance of Psyche, in essence, to kind of come into her own divinity, that kind of balancing of masculine, feminine energy. In a very spiritual sense, I believe. And in the midst of this wide quietness, a rosy sanctuary will I dress with a wreathed trellis of a working brain, with buds and bells and stars without a name, with all the gardener fancy ever could feign, who breeding flowers will never breed the same. And there shall be for thee all soft delight, the shadow thought can win, a bright torch and a casement ope at night, to let the warm love in. So I love how Keats totally progresses Psyche from mortal to goddess, and then embraces her divinity as goddess, as her priest, and that whole kind of ebb and flow of exchange of energy between the two. And this last poem I'm going to read was very much inspired by this idea of holy union or sacred love, the sacred partnership of coming together. And it's a different version of Psyche based on the traditional Greek the myth. But this time around, it speaks of more Heraclitean themes and how that aletheia or aletheia, truth, the Greek word for truth, and how we negate the Greek word of truth with the a, and then we leave lethe, which is the mythical river that runs through Hades, and how this these particular waters of Lethe would conceal the truth, that kind of ebb and flow from consciousness to unconsciousness, and how basically Plato talks about this two-faced, or gets Aristophanes, in essence, to talk about this two-faced, four-legged creature, the soul, if you will, that Zeus separates because it's too powerful. And these two holes, or halves, depending on how you see it or do not, search for each other throughout eternity, some coming together, some coming apart and separating, this ebb and flow, very similar to Psyche and Eros, Osiris and Sias, Penelope and Odysseus, and how it touches on that theme of sacred love, or Hieros Gamos. So, Psyche's cup, and it's written in sonnet form. Come, beloved one, drink from the river Lethe, hypnotic waters that sparkle dizzy, to forget the parted memory of the twin soul, not the other half, but rather your whole. She is obliged, the river goddess to him, Hades, of whom she flows like fluid emotion, as sleep into the netherworld of oblivion. Imbibe her essence and allow the dark to dim, in complete forgetfulness made numb. Drink from the daughter of strife and heal your wounds clean from earthly life. Your reunion comes with the chaliced cup, tonic to relieve the heart's wounds, soothe. Come, child, drink, embrace divine truth. So, I want to thank you very much for your patience in coming out.